Hey everyone, today we're learning about SPI devices and the Flipper Zero. First we'll look at a CC1101 external radio. Then we'll look at the serial clock speed communicating with a flash memory module. And then finally we'll look at integrating with the WS2812B LED, which lacks a serial clock wire, so it's not an SPI device, but we should be able to use the SPI bus to control it. Let's get started. Here's a quick review from the previous video. Pin 2, MOSI, main output sub input, so data from the flipper. Pin 3, MISO, main input sub output, so data for the flipper. Pin 4 is chip select, so that wire's low to talk to the device. Pin 5 is a serial clock that controls when we read and write data. It's controlled by the flipper. Pin 8 is our ground, and pin 9 is our power. These are all the pins defined by SPI. Our external CC1101 uses one more wire, GD0, and GD0 is used for sending and receiving asynchronous data. I have my logic analyzer hooked up to the CC1101, and channel 2 in red is the GD0 line. I just clicked the remote for a third time. And you can see the 5 repeated key lock signals each of the 3 times I press the remote. At the bottom of the screen is the initialization data that the flipper sends for the AM650 modulation. And we can see that data being sent on the MOSI pin. Next, I'll zoom out. And then we'll zoom in to the GD0 data, which is the flipper is receiving the signal. So this is the signal coming from my remote control, and you can see these pulses. And then next I'll zoom out and we can look at the RSSI request from the flipper. So the flipper on the MOSI pin is going to send a F4, which is request for RSSI. And we see we got back a 3.7, which is a strong signal. The lower the number, the stronger the signal. So here we're sending out an F4, and this time we got back a signal of 3.5. So let's go ahead and zoom into this. Looks like a little bit of noise. We'll zoom into that. We can see we're sending our F4, and we're getting back an E6. So it's a very weak signal on the RSSI. And in channel 2, we can see some other pulses, probably from the neighbor's device. Let's zoom in and look at that. And it's an E6, so a stray signal from some device, not our remote. So GD0 is used for asynchronous sending and receiving of data. That's where we get our information. And then the MOSI and MISO pins are used for things like configuring the radio and getting the signal strength. In the previous video, we looked at the code to read and write on the SPI bus. And now I'm going to go into the definition of that bus handle, and this is defined in the F7 firmware. And you can see that that callback is this external event callback. And you can see that that external event callback is going to this preset. And if we go to that definition, you'll see that the baud rate is DIV32. And DIV32 means that we're going to take our clock speed of 64 megahertz, and we're going to divide it by 32. And so that means the clock speed of the SPI bus controlled by the flipper, that SCK wire, is going to be 2 megahertz. And if we invert that and multiply it to find out the nanoseconds, it's 500 nanoseconds per pulse. So I have the SPI memory manager here, and I have my digital logic analyzer running. We're going to go ahead and record with the default firmware using 2M, which is, again, 2 megahertz is our external SPI. And you can see now we're reading from the memory chip. I'm going to do a cut here and jump ahead in the video so we can get to the end. And then next what we're going to do is zoom in and take a look at this clock. And we can see that we're at a frequency of 2 megahertz. and the flipper took 100 seconds to read the chip. This time I flashed my firmware using low underscore 8M, and 8M is using a divisor of 8 instead of a divisor of 32, and so 64 megahertz divided by 8 is 8 megahertz. So notice this time we're reading the dump a little bit faster. I'll do another hard cut here. And this time it took 74 seconds instead of 100 seconds to read the same chip. And when we zoom in and look at that clock, you can see this time that our frequency was 8 megahertz for our clock. So again, in this case, I changed my actual firmware and I recompiled it with that low underscore 8M, which gave me a divisor of 8, which made my external SPI run quicker. In the next section, we'll look at how our code can do something similar without requiring a recompile of firmware. So next, we're going to use the Flipper Zero MOSI pin to control some WS2812B LEDs. So controlling these LEDs is tricky because we need such a fast clock. We basically need an 8 megahertz clock. So I've gone ahead and defined an 8M handle external. And that 8M handle external has this callback that we've defined. And our callback uses an 8M, one edge low 8M. And then the external handle event callback is an internal API. And so I just copy pasted the method from FruiHal SPI config into my code. So now our SPI is at 8 megahertz. And the datasheet says you can be plus or minus 150 nanoseconds of error. And you can see that our error ranges are all less than that. So if we send 3 ones and 6 zeros, we'll get a pulse of 375 nanoseconds and then a gap of 750 nanoseconds. And if we send 6 ones and then 3 zeros, we'll get a pulse of 750 nanoseconds and a gap of 375 nanoseconds. So I've converted those 9-bit numbers into 8-bit hex with brightness 7, 3, 1, and 0. And then for each of the 16 lights, we defined the amount of green, red, and blue. And then in our code, we're going to just do our handle init, acquire that 8 megahertz SPI bus, and then we're going to use TX to transmit our byte array, and then finally we'll release the SPI in dinit. You can see on line 138, we loop 10 times, sending 10 signals to try to make that light work. In this second pulse here, you can see there's all kinds of like gap and stuff. Again, the flipper owns the clock, and so SPI would actually say that was a perfectly good signal. However, our WS2812 does not have that clock line. Even in our last pulse, we can see there's a little gap here. Instead of 375, we're at 437 nanoseconds. But the spec called for 400 plus or minus 150, so we're still within tolerance when we miss a pulse in our clock. But if the clock does have lots of errors in it, you will end up with the lights not working correctly. Most of these lights are at the wrong brightness and color and are consuming the wrong amount of current as well. And again, this is because those lights don't have a clock signal, and so these gaps potentially impact the data signal that we're sending to the lights. So now you know all about SPI. You know how the CC1101 uses SPI plus GD0 for async data. You know how to increase the speed of your SPI external bus. And you even know how to control WS2812B using SPI. In a future video, I'll teach you about timer APIs so we can reliably control the length of our pulses for devices that don't have a serial clock wire. Please like and subscribe. Also, please join my Discord server for giveaways and to let me know what devices you want to control with your flipper.